Hi and welcome to this week's special episode of the show. It's very special because we're out of my living room. We're actually out and about. There's no more Zoom. We're actually here with a real person, and we're going to be discussing collecting, collectors, collectibles, what's it all about, and also antiques and bric-a-brac, books. And to talk about it with me is Charles Leski. Hello, Charles.
Nice to have you in the building.
In the building. I'm in the building. I haven't left yet. But fascinating stuff you have here. You've got a wonderful... it's an auction house, isn't it, really?
Yeah, it's an auction house. So it's a constant changing barrage of stuff depending on what the next auction is. Last week was sporting memorabilia. Next week it's Australian and colonial and historical things. So we have the fun of preparing a catalogue, putting it on display, sharing the fun with people for a couple of weeks, and then that all goes and the next theme, the next collection comes up.
Because you've had some record prices on things like sports memorabilia. We've got something here which is probably just going to go for $10, but it's the Gloves of Irony. It's the Rod Marsh book, right, which is really great. That's a piece of sporting memorabilia. We've also got a little laurel wreath here. It's a trophy of some sort. St Kilda Sporting Club?
We believe it was on the table at the celebratory dinner for the 1966 Grand Final.
Right. And another piece of sporting memorabilia that I found wandering around was the Melbourne Cup, the running of the Melbourne Cup on 78 RPM.
It's the running of the 1933 Cup, yeah. Not Farlap, which would have gone for a lot of money.
Yeah.
The winner in 1933 was a horse called Hallmark.
Hallmark.
Largely forgotten these days.
All we can remember about Hallmark is that they do good greeting cards.
That's right.
And also we have things like another collector's item that I would love to buy is Martin Sharp's cartoons. He was very famous.
1960s, late 60s, yeah.
He did the cartoons for that wonderful magazine.
Oz magazine, that's right.
In London.
And in Australia. And he is also much loved now for some of his original posters. He did posters for Bob Dylan.
Yes.
And for Donovan. And
for their tours.
That's for their tours. Mm. So those posters in good condition can be worth a couple of $1,000s now. He was ahead of his time.
He certainly was, and he was a great guy. I knew Martin personally through mutual friends in Sydney. He really came to Melbourne. He was a great Sydney sider.
Yes,
he loved his Sydney. And this week's sale is going to be in this catalogue, which we'll show you a few as I flick through it. We'll have a look at some of the wonderful offerings you have here, which are extraordinary because the variety here is this piece here we're going to look at right now. Tell us a little bit about this really unattractive...
I can't see what you're looking at. Oh, this is...
Very unattractive face.
This is...
a really important
it's,
piece.
Yes, it's by John Percival.
Yes.
It's quite heavy, and while he's best known for his paintings, his pottery and sculptures are very much... in demand. This one's never been on the market before, so it came as a surprise to the vendor that it was Percival. He couldn't read the signature underneath, but we recognised it, so he's going to get a few $1,000s worth of a surprise.
From pottery we go to wood, because there's a beautiful piece. I used to collect this stuff here, which I'm going to show you. It's in the catalogue, but here it is in real. No, you can hold the catalogue. It's a two-sided. I mean, they used to do amazing work with all sorts of Australia. I recognize the hewn pine and the black wood and the myrtle.
There's musk and
musk,
cedar.
Yeah.
They're called exhibition tables. And they're designed to show the workmanship.
Another one in the window as well, which is a pedestal table that becomes a wine table.
You just don't see that sort of work anymore.
No, you don't. And so the catalogue's full of all... You're having a sale on the 28th and 29th.
28th and 29th.
So it's all online. You don't have sale... When was the last time you had an actual in-house sale here?
It's been an interesting time in my 48-year career. The last 6 months.
Old. Come on, you must have started.
I was in shorts.
Short of money.
Short of money and in shorts. It's the first time we've had to conduct auctions without anybody in the room. And that used to be quite a challenge.
Yeah.
But fortunately, with the internet, live streaming, cameras, we've had some of our most successful auctions. And people have been very understanding and supportive, because people come here for two reasons. They want to view the items, yeah, as you are. They want to wander around. They want to look at them. They want to fall in love with them. They want to check the condition. And then they want to come here and participate in the theatre of the auction.
Yeah.
But we couldn't do that for the last 6 months. So
they couldn't come in at all.
They couldn't come to view, and they certainly couldn't come and sit down for several hours and, you know, wait for the lot that was of interest to them. So we were allowed to continue to conduct auctions because it was effectively, therefore, an online auction.
Yeah.
And so we've had some of our most successful auctions, but having to answer hundreds and hundreds of questions about condition, provenance, extra photographs.
Do they do it online, or do you get
it's either on the phone or via our website? And people got the idea very quickly. So we had an auction about a month ago. It was a single owner, a deceased estate. His name was Jeffrey Burke. He had been a curator at the National Gallery of Victoria, passed away about a year ago, and we effectively got the contents of the house. We had nearly 1,000 people participating with not a single person in the room.
Wow.
And 100% clearance of the lots and nearly 300% of the pre-sale estimate. So we would not have picked that ever to be how we would be operating in 2020, but what about 2020 was predictable from anybody?
Nobody.
So we've worked hard, but it's been successful. And this auction, this Australian and historical auction, will be the first one where we are open for viewing in a COVID appropriate way. So we can't have, 100 people in here viewing. No. It has to be, so many metres per...
It's like a big balagun to me at the moment. Are you going to set it up?
It is a balagun. No, we'll just let people wander around. No. No, everything is on display. Yeah. There's staff nearby as we speak, numbering things. We're putting things on display. It'll be well organised and everybody will come in and view.
Yeah.
And then we will be able to allocate a limited number of seating positions to people during the auction. On the phone and online. Yeah. Online. A lot of people have realised they can come and view,
yeah,
and then they can go home and they can watch the auctioneer.
Yep.
And there's a bid button. You just have to press it any time you want. They can hear us. They can see it, and they can participate as if they were here.
We have so much more I want to talk about. We'll be back after the break with Charles Leski for another segment, because Charlie's got a big shtick. Thanks, mate.